Isn't God good?
All the time.
Yeah. Stand up. Old school. Yeah. Ain't God good? Praise God. Let's find tell me you're looking good in the Lord. Who this loud? All right, you're looking good in the Lord. All right, look, say, look. Say, I'm glad to be in God's house. This is God's house. I don't have my thing up there, so we're just going to give it. We're going to give it our own little thing today. Ready? I'm glad to be in God's house. This is His service. We're going to worship Him, and we thank Him for what He's doing. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And the church said, amen. Amen. Get on ahead and clap and pray.
My eyes to the wonders of you. You captured my.
Father, just what we need before you say a word. You're a million fire. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who I am.
surgeon said, do you mind if I pray with you? And so the surgeon prayed with Sylvia before they took her out. And then when the surgeon called us back in the room and talked to us, me and Steve and the surgeon all held hands, and we prayed together and thanked God for what he did. That is so awesome. So, so awesome to know that a surgeon would do that. Amen. Praise God, praise God. You got your Bible, turn to the book of Job. Job. Turn to the book of Job. You say, well, I don't have a job. Yeah, it's right here. Job, the book of Job. Job. Ain't God good? Remember, we're doing on the very first Sunday of the month, we've been doing Job. It's been back to basics, but Job has been the main one, and I'm taking my time going through Job just like we're taking our time going through Revelation. Do you realize we started Revelation last year, and we just got to the black horse? That's amazing. So coming up, we're going to talk about the witnesses, and after that, you're not going to want to miss it. In 2 weeks, I'm going to tell you, whether you're post-trib, pre-trib, A-trib, no-trib, any trib, I'm going to tell you how to survive Revelation, how to survive now, and how to survive when the tribulation starts. I'm going to tell you how to survive. So if you get stuck behind or however the rapture is going to take place, pre-trib, post-trib, most-trib, it's going to happen. Amen. You're going to know how to survive this until God comes back. Amen. So everybody stand. This in 2 weeks. We're going to talk about that. Everybody stand. The book of Job. You got to say amen.
Amen.
You don't say on me. All right. Now again, I'm not going to take it all the way from the very front, but I am going to take it some from the first chapter. And that is, here it is, first chapter, let's just look, chapter 1, verse 20. Chapter 1, verse 20. Now you got to know now, the devil and God have been having a conversation, and the devil, who is the accuser of the brother, accused God that he was so good to Job, and accused Job that he had been done so good, he was spoiled, that he would not hold up under trial. So God said, I'll take everything, you do anything you want to, just don't touch his body. He lost his children, he lost his land, he lost his livestock, he lost his livelihood, he loses everything. And then he says, verse 20, then Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshipped and said, naked I came out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord have taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Chapter 2. Again there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said unto Satan, from whence thou comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? And still he holds fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without a cause. Literally took everything he had. And Satan answered, said the sword and said, skin for skin, yea, all that a man hath he will give for his life. But put forth thine hand now, and touch his bone in his flesh, and he will curse thee to thy face. In other words, I've touched him on the outside, I've touched everything that was dear to him, but Lord, let me touch him now. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, he is in thy hand, but save his life. So went Satan forth from the presence of the Lord, and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his feet into his crown. And he took him a potsherd to scrape himself withal, and sat down among the ashes. Then said his wife unto him, thus thou wilt still retain thy integrity, curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. Why shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this did not Job sin with his lips. Now when Job's three friends heard this, and they go about his friends have come, and they come to lift him up. And of course, we'll talk about that later, because they don't do a very good job of lifting him up.
Amen.
All right, stretch forth your hands this way. Father, we love you, Lord. We praise your name. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you, God, that your power is unstoppable. We thank you, God, that you showed us time and time and time again your greatness and your power and your authority and how you can do anything. We thank you, God, that Job, although it's the oldest book in the Bible, it clearly shows us your power in everything. And I ask you right now to touch us all, to help us learn today, and find a way to hold on when they don't feel like they can. In the name of Jesus, we pray. The church said,
amen.
On the way down, tell somebody, if you're not here after what I'm here after, you'll be here after I'm gone. Go ahead, right there. A sailor didn't like anything he saw in the chow line, so he just picked up a large piece of chocolate cake. The cook asked, is that all you're going to eat? The sailor said, yeah, the rest of it doesn't look too appetizing. The cook smiled and said, well, in that case, would you like two pieces of cake? The sailor said, yeah, man, I'd appreciate that. So the cook leaned over and cut the sailor's piece of cake in half. Have you ever felt like you were shortchanged in life? Have you ever felt like you got the bottom end of the totem pole, you got the bottom end of the shaft? Well, if anybody had the bottom end, that would be our brother Job. Job is the oldest book in the Bible. And not only is it the oldest book in the Bible, Job lived around the time of the Exodus, somewhere around that time of the Exodus, or at least during the first five books of the Bible, they're being recorded by Moses. Now, the book of Job is recorded. And here I am sitting there like I got nothing to do over here. Hold on. Praise God, praise God. Look at somebody say, if his head weren't attached, somebody say that. Good, I'm glad you understand. Alright. Let's see here. Okay. Here we go. Now we got her. Okay. Storms out of nowhere. Storms out of nowhere. That's what we're talking about with Job, is out of nowhere. Okay? Have you ever been doing good in life and out of nowhere, all of a sudden the doctor calls, or you have a doctor's appointment, or you get a recall on a CPAP machine that you've used for 7 years. Or you find out that your child has cancer. Or you find out that your wife has got this problem or that problem. Or the doctor says there's nothing we can no longer do for that person in the family. You know, my cousin, George Linton, he put down both kids for a living. George was my age, and he was a big man. He made me look small. He was a big, big guy. He was healthy as an ox. And because he put down both kids, he was strong as two baggers. And he and his wife's sisters, somebody got COVID and passed it around. And they were all sick, and his wife and him wound up going to Boca County Hospital. She got out yesterday after 12 days. He got flown, airlifted to Pitmore Hospital. The blood clots in his legs, they went to his lungs. And bless him, he died Friday at 9 a.m. Healthy as an ox. So you got to understand, life comes at such a speed. And trials come and tribulations. And it's hard to understand why things happen the way they do. But Job, out of nowhere, he had troubles and he had problems. He had persecution. And he had a powerful pain. I mean, can you imagine losing all 10 of your children at one time? Losing all your resources back to back to back within no time. You've lost all your resources. You've lost your way to make a living. You've lost everything. It's just been, your whole life has become bankrupt. Amen? Can you imagine? Your relationships are bankrupt. And all this other stuff that's going on has become bankrupt in your life. In this world, you're going to have tribulation, but take heart. I have overcome the world. That's Jesus talking in John 16. The night before he's going to be taken away, or the night he was going to be taken away from them, and face the cross. So, out of nowhere, I just think about us, out of nowhere, in 2020, or in 2019, we were talking about 2020, and it was going to be a year where our eyes were going to be open. And I wasn't the only one that felt that our eyes are going to be open. I heard other preachers preaching it too, that our eyes are going to be opened. We just had no idea they were going to be opened the way they were in 2020. Life has come at us out of nowhere. COVID-19, there was the shutdowns. It was going to be for 14 days. There's 2020-21. There's still things that are shut down. They just finally passed a bill that pastors can go be with their people in the hospital. Just passed that bill. So when Steve and Sylvia were there Saturday, I started easing up on it because I got a chance to go visit some people, but I had to be quick about it. I had to leave. But just a couple weeks ago, they passed a bill because they closed it back up and said, you can't come back. One day I could go to the hospital, one day I couldn't go. One day I could go upstairs, the next day I had to stay downstairs. It was just crazy. But they passed a bill where the pastors can go visit their people in the hospital. In the pit, if the pastor has a badge, he doesn't even count as a person. That sounded kind of rough, didn't it? In other words, one person can be there with the person that's sick. And if I have a badge, I don't have to be that person. I can be there too. Amen? So again, I thank God that there is some people that's working around some of this junk that's going on. But you look at the forecast and you think about all the riots and you think about all the shutdowns and you think about all the junk that just keeps going on. And every day, used to I was surprised at what I saw. And every day now when I see things, I'm no longer surprised. The shock value has been taken away. Have you noticed that? The shock value is gone. I mean, stuff has happened so fast and happened so quick, but we don't realize that's what I'm doing in Revelation 2 is because we're being conditioned so when the Antichrist does show up on the scene, we're going to welcome him. We're going to think that every day is normal because of all this stuff that we're being conditioned by now. So let's look at here just quick. We made some discoveries in chapter 1. The ruler of the storm, of course, was God. Wasn't Satan. People say, well, you know, I hear him say all this stuff. Well, Job brought it on himself because he said, that which I feared has come upon me. I hear these prosperity, you ever heard a prosperity preacher say that Job brought it on himself because he said, what I feared, I brought on me? You ever heard that? I have. I got a Hebrew explanation for that. Matter of fact, that is another one. Job didn't bring it on. God and Satan were having a discussion. And Job was the target, but God said, if you consider my servant Job, and Satan said, I can't touch him. He said, but if you let me touch him, I bet you he'll curse you and die, or curse you to your face. And he said, well, go ahead. So the ruler of the storm is God. The reason for the storm is Satan. The reach of the storm was all that he possessed. And the reaction to the storm was praise. That's all in chapter 1. I just read it. It is so awesome. He said, Job said, naked I came out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return hither. The Lord gave, and the Lord had taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. If Job sinned not, then how in the world did it come on him because he was not faithful? Silly. Some of y'all in here right now, you're going through things and you wonder, did I mess up? Did I blow it? Did I take the wrong turn? Did I not do good enough for you, God? Why am I suffering through this right now? You're thinking it's something you've done when you don't understand that there is times that happens, but you got to understand this too is there is a spiritual force going on around us. You can't necessarily see it. But right now, if you could see right now, if God would open your eyes, you could see the demons fighting for you not to hear this. But at the same time, you see the angels pushing them away. Okay? So the choice is yours, because they're, like you see on the little cartoons, the little devil and the little angel, think about that as a reality. Really happened. Okay, so he said, God is sovereign and God is my source. So he's coming through, or so far he's coming through okay. But just when he thought it couldn't get any worse, I mean here, thought it couldn't get any worse, and then guess what? Amen. It got worse. So again, I'm not going to take too long today, but I wanted to, sometimes we don't quite understand these few verses I just read is so full because it takes the entire book of Job to explain those three or four verses I just read. Okay? So let's go ahead. So I see it. Verses is the timing. Look at the timing of this storm. Of course, the turn for the worst came at a time of restlessness. He had just lost everything. And he's trying to come to grips with losing everything. It's a time of readjustment. How am I gonna adjust to not have my kids anymore? How am I gonna adjust to not having my business anymore? How am I gonna adjust to not being the man in charge anymore? So he's rebuilding, trying to rebuild what's going on because everything has been taken from him. Everything has been taken. I can't say it enough. Everything has been taken on the outside. So, Job sees that he maintained his integrity. So Job gets permission from God to touch him. So now, Job's whole world is about to crumble again. Just when he's readjusting, just when he's finally just trying to come to grips, you know, Bethany's been dead now for 2 years. This year will be 3, and I still have a hard time coming to grips with it. You know, just the other day, it's like I go to the hospital and walk by the cancer center. It's inevitably somebody's going to walk by that looks just like her. Or I'll be in the house and I'll hear her calling for help in the back room, still. You know, or I'll go places and I'll start hearing Bethany speak to me again. And so I'm still adjusting to Bethany's death. You know, so this isn't something Job just pops up and goes, okay, I will, let's go ahead. No, he lost 10 youngins and his business. And he had multiple businesses and lost them all. He lost all of his employees. He lost everything. Him and his wife having to start over again. Without looking around, without saying anything to anybody, just quietly close your eyes for just a moment. And if you're there right now, say, thank you, God, that I'm here today. If you think you're going that way, again, thank God that you're here today. If you know somebody that's going through this, again, you thank God that you're here today. What I'm getting ready to describe is going to be tough. But I want you to really see. I mean, really see. You can open your eyes. I want you to really see. And we still can't even fathom what Job was going through. The first attack led to financial crisis. It led to employment crisis. And it led to family crisis. He lost his business. He lost his employees. He lost his family. He lost his livestock. He lost the barns they were in. He lost it all. Literally bankrupt. I want you to know something. He kept on praising God anyway. Satan can't stand, and Satan can't tolerate a God attitude and pride. Let me say it again. Some of y'all need to hear this very loud. Satan cannot stand, Satan cannot tolerate a God, I didn't say good attitude, I said a God attitude in trial. There's times when I not necessarily smile in my trial, but I try to keep a God attitude. Just like Job, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I will return. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You think when that happens, it's going to get better. But remember, not only can Satan not stand it, he will not tolerate it. Again, understand the forces at work here. Satan is trying to find doorways. And out of all people, God has opened the door for him. That's hard to understand, isn't it? That's hard to comprehend. Satan says, I can't touch him. I touched him. You said I could touch everything you had. I did. He's still not cussing you. And God said, okay. Touch his body. Job didn't institute the trial. Not only did he not institute the trial, God and Satan did. But now the doorway to the next set of trials, he did not open. Can you? Is that even comprehensible? The second doorway, Job did not open. God did. Wow. If you watch any prosperity preachers on TV and they're talking that junk, turn them off. Because they're filling your mind full of junk. I'm reading you the Word of God. And the Word of God says, Satan said, okay, take your hands off his body and I'll show you what he'll do. So God opened the door. Now his friends didn't see it that way. His friends had to be prosperity preachers. Larry, Curly, and Moe, all three of them. So because he could not stand, Satan cannot stand or tolerate a God attitude of trial, don't expect Satan to accept his defeat. He won't. We will accept it. Oh, yeah, you know, well, we try to get through the door, and if we trip on the doormat trying to get in the door, well, that must be Russell B going to church today. I'm tripping on the doormat, going out of the house. And Satan's going, I can't wait to get to church so I can talk to everybody and tell them how stupid that man is up there. And how everybody hates me. You, that is. Satan's having a heyday. He has a heyday because he will not accept his defeat. He keeps on punching and punching and punching and punching. And the problem is, he keeps on punching and we quit getting up. Wow. That's powerful. That's powerful. So now, that's what he is. The second attack led to physical crisis and relational crisis. What I'm talking about? Watch this. I'm just going to classify them. You can write them down if you want to. And I keep saying I'm going to make some outlines. I can make outlines from Job 2 if you want them. That's all right. So you can have these. But I wanted to try to describe what Job was going through. We just said, oh, he broke out in boils from his feet to his head, and he sat on the ash pile and took a broken pot and tried to scrape the boils off. You know what? That's only the tip of the iceberg. Get ready. If you have good stomachs, I could show you some pictures of what doctors have described. His illness. I'm not going to show any pictures, but I do have scripture. First, he got boils. Anybody ever got a boil? Boils hurt. They mean they swell up. You know, they swell up and they'll burst, and it's just awful. But until you break the boil, the pressure just keeps on and on and on, and it tears your skin. And so you take the boil and take that pot and just scrape it to lance it. So he had boils. He had uncontrollable itching. I know we've all had some uncontrollable itching before. The Bible said he had a drastic change in appearance. His friends didn't even recognize him. I'm going to go to that one in a minute. The Bible says in chapter 3, verse 24, he had difficulty eating. In 3:25, he was depressed. Chapter 7, he had worms.
See, the first three couple, first two or three verses, he had boils and he sent them pot and he sent them the ashes and he scraped them off and, you know, well, bless his heart. And then we're all going to say, well, Job, he was such an awesome dude. He just stood up under it. No, the man was mentally depressed because his body was falling apart. Satan doesn't, look, Satan's not like us. He won't do anything halfway. We take spiritual warfare in halfway fight. He takes spiritual warfare very serious. God said touch his body, you just can't take his life. So guess what he did? He touched his body. Boils, itching, a drastic change in appearance, difficulty eating, mental depression, worms, running sores. Oh, it gets even worse. Shortness of breath. Darkness around his eyes. Odorous breath. Loss of weight. Corroding bones. His bones were collapsing within him. Gnawing pain. Blackened skin. And fever. Now, when you see all this, that puts a whole different thought on Job. Got boils from foot to head, and sat on the ash pile and scraped off his boils. This puts a whole different outlook on him. This man was run through the ringer. If it's ever possible to be run through the ringer, matter of fact, doctors have looked at it. And as doctors have looked at it, they said that he had a terminal disease. Why not? He lost everything else. He lost his body. So what's left? Just die. That's what his wife said. What he had, they call it elephantitis or leiotitis or black leprosy. Black leprosy, according to the doctors, your temperatures will run, the small temperatures will run between 103 and 105. I remember it was 4 weeks I was sick years ago, and every night my temperature went to 103 and 104. And I remember laying in the bed one night, and I said, God, I literally said, God, please take me. And all I had was the fever, and couldn't eat. It was just sore everywhere. And I remember laying in bed and said, God, won't you just take me? Multiple nights. I can't even imagine all this stuff this guy's going through. Then depression setting in. The Bible talks about the things, but if you look in the medical journals, when a person gets black leprosy, he doesn't even look like himself anymore. There's erosion of the bones. He has terrifying nightmares. He has images flash before his brain, before his eyes. Honestly, I don't know how you can be touched anymore in the body than Job. It's amazing to me is this is the oldest book in the Bible. The oldest book in the Bible talks and addresses spiritual warfare. It addresses Satan. It addresses the Father. It addresses angels. It addresses friends. It addresses sickness. It addresses trials. And also at the end of this, I'm going to tell you more about the trials. But what it does is, I believe God put that there as the oldest book is because God was going to use that to help people through all generations that are going through something. We've all gone through things. Sometimes we think it's through and there's another one. Then we think it's through and there's another one. We think something's going to get better and it gets worse. But you know what? God took the greatest man the absolute greatest man of his time, and used him to show something. Here he is. Let me just kind of go over this. Boils, itching, addressing change in appearance, difficulty eating, mental depression, worms and running sores, shortness of breath, darkness of eyes, odorous breath, loss of weight, corroding bones, gnawing pain, blackened skin, and high fevers of at least 105. Wow. Don't raise your hand. Don't point. But if that happened to you, how many could go, praise God! Glory! Because I remember just that night with that fever. And I was feeling so bad. And I couldn't eat everything I needed. I'd throw up. And it was just terrible. And I remember laying a couple times in the bed and said, God, just take me. I can't even imagine. When this stuff happens to you, you have a choice. Here's your choice. You can grow bitter, or you can grow better. Of course, Job, he grew better. God never allows trial without a purpose. He let all this happen to Job. He turned Satan loose on him, not to destroy Job, believe it or not, but to prove to Satan there's still people out there that you can beat up every way you can, and God still gets glory. I talked about it here, I don't know, but when Daniel got in that car wreck and they told him that we run to the hospital, we took him to Beaufort County Hospital, and I walked inside there and all those big burly rescue guys and police that all Daniel had worked with, they're in there crying. And I said, why are these guys crying? And I see Daniel on the table, and he could only move one arm, just a little bit. And when I got to him, he couldn't even move his neck. He said, Dad, come here. And I come to him. And he said, Dad, don't let me do anything. Just let me die. And I remember when they took him to Greenville. They said, you can't come in yet. We're going to do a CT scan. So they run a scan on him in the trauma room. They let me go in, and Michelle was in there, and DC came in. And I remember Daniel said, Daddy, cover up my feet. My feet are cold. And DC was at his feet. DC came up to me with tears in his eyes. And he said, Daddy, your feet are cold. Remember that, DC? Your feet are cold. And I looked at Daniel, and Daniel had a little tear in his eye. And he said, Daddy, I'm worthless. I'm absolutely worthless. I can't even move. Just let me die. And I said, son, you got to give God a chance. And when DC came up and said, his feet are covered, Dad. DC had already been talking about building ramps at his house. DC said, his feet are covered, so I looked at Daniel, and I pulled out, of course I don't have one now, but this is only a dollar. But I pulled out a $20 bill, and I looked at Daniel, and I said, what's this? He said, a $20 bill. I said, what's it worth? He said, $20. I folded it and said, now what's it worth? He said, $20. And I crumbled it. And I said, now what's it worth? He said, Daddy, it's still worth $20. And I threw it on the ground. I chased it down up here. And I just twisted my foot on it like that. And I said, now what's it worth, Daniel? He said, $20. I said, son, you've been folded. You've been crushed. You've been stopped. I said, but you still got value in God's eyes. You ain't got to stop. When DC came up and told me that his feet were covered, DC got up and talked to Daniel, and I went down to Daniel's feet. I grabbed his feet and they were cold. And I grabbed his feet without some big old hurrah with cameras on me and recording every word I said. And all that was just me and God and Satan. And I stood at Daniel's feet. Nobody heard me. It was just me. And I said, I grabbed my son's feet. And I said, Satan, this is in between me and you. This is in between you and Daniel. This is between my God and you. I said, this boy, my wife was honest, we have children. And we had these two boys. And then Daniel had cystic fibrosis. He should have already been dead by now. I said, I don't believe he's going down like this now. And I said, Satan, again, it's not me fighting you, it's my Father. I said, God showed your power. And I grabbed his feet and I just closed my eyes. And all of a sudden, peace ran through me. And I walked up to Daniel. And I said, Daniel, he said, Daddy, just let it go, just let it go, just let it go. And I said, Daniel, you've got a chance. And about that time, the doctor came in and said, Mr. Lynn, y'all not going to believe this. I said, try us. He said, there's not a broken bone in his body. They just told him that his back was broken, his core was severed. Just told him that before they went out. I just took a CT scan. And now they're going, we can't find a broken bone in his body. But he got hit in his back. He still took him a month to walk. Because he had a birth defect in his spinal cord. And when that truck was totaled out, that birth defect was squeezed. And it just, his spinal cord was just useless. It took about a month. Six months later, he was jumping out of helicopters in Afghanistan. Nothing is impossible for him. Nothing is impossible for God. Whatever you're going through today, whether you're going through mental, spiritual, physical, financial bankruptcy, that you feel like your whole world has crumbled before you, remember, you still got value in God's eyes. Job grew better. Watch. But his wife, she grew bitter. He would have pounced on her and beat her up and tell her, why, you he said she's like a foolish woman, but we would have beat her up on her, but you got to realize she lost her business. She lost her kids. Everything Job lost, she everything. And then after losing everything, she's looking at a husband and his body is broken, crippled, depressed. And so she says, won't you just curse God and die? In other words, there's nothing to this God stuff. Why don't you just go ahead and admit it? God ain't done anything for you. Go ahead and admit it. God ain't working for you. Go ahead and admit it, Joe. And then just die. Wow. What a difference. A little bit further. So I said unto him, thou still retain thy integrity. Curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speak. Why, shall we receive good at the hand of God and not receive evil? And all this again, Job didn't sin with his lips. You see, Adam yielded to Eve. Look at the mess for him. But Job refused to yield. And look at the testimony. A powerful, powerful testimony. You see, The book of Job, because it is the first book in the Bible, it's not written down up here, so I'll just tell you. Book of Job shows us, number one, the extent. Listen carefully. The extent that God will allow trials in your life. We've been so enamored by the prosperity gospel. You know, if you go into a Chinese restaurant today, you're going to get Americanized Chinese food. Did you know that? If you go to a Mexican restaurant, you're going to get Americanized Mexican food. It's when you see the thing written in some kind of language you don't understand and it says authentic, that's when it's no longer Americanized. You know where chop suey came from? Chop suey did not come from the Orient. Chop suey came because the man couldn't sell all the stuff he made that day, so he threw it all in a pot and chopped it up. He went outside and said, suey! Yeah, ain't that funny? Yeah, buddy. It's Americanized. And if we're not careful, we have Americanized God. Do you know our version of the gospel? Here's what it should be. Our version of the gospel should be able to be preached anywhere, anytime, any place. And if your version of the gospel cannot be preached anytime, anywhere, any place, then you've got an Americanized gospel. God does allow suffering, but it always has a purpose. God's more concerned with your character than your comfort. So watch this. The book of Job shows us the extent that God will allow a trial to go. But the book of Job also shows us an example of human endurance and human spirit. The closest I could even feel like it was not when I had the fever, but Bethany's up in the hospital and they're telling me we've done all we can do. We're going to keep on doing radiation or back. We're going to quit all the other chemotherapy, immunotherapy, blah, 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 all that stuff. We're going to quit all that. And I got Bethany saying, Daddy, don't quit fighting. And I said, I'm not quitting fighting, Bethany, but I can't do what I can do. And then Linda, because we thought Bethany was getting better, had the hysterectomy. And when she had her surgery, on that Saturday, she had blood clots in her liver, and they carried her to the hospital, and they put her on one end of the cancer ward and Bethany on the other end. And for 4 days, the doctor would come to me with tears in her eyes, the doctors, and say, Mr. Linton, we are so sorry. You could lose your wife or your daughter anytime. Can we give you something? I said, I got something. It's called Jesus. And the doctors would hold me, cry, and even pray with me. And I remember sitting, walking the halls by myself. And here's what I said. God, I thank you that I've got you. And God, I thank you that you've let me see just a peep of what Job went through. And I thank you, God, that I'm not going through this by myself. You got this. Take the Americanized version out and take the gospel for what it says. Take it for what it says, not for what some other guy has come up with and go by his recipe. take the gospel for what it says. If you start following somebody else's teaching, that's all they say, that's the only thing you follow, then guess what? You take the power of the gospel. So the extent, God will allow suffering and trial. The example of human endurance and spirit and empowering because of the blessing at the end. I can't wait to get to the end because it's going to be powerful. This guy, I'm not sure how long it was. It could have been 2 months, 3 months. It could have been 6, 7 months. And I was not sure how long it lasted. But it was inside of a year this guy goes through hell. Pure hell. Now, let me tell you something about storms. First, storms are sovereignly designed for my benefit. Your storms are sovereignly designed for your benefit. You say that. Now you're barking up the wrong tree. I'm telling you, take the Americanization out and get the gospel. Christ carried a cross up Calvary's hill. Christ was beat beyond recognition. So you can say, I know how you feel when you feel like you're not even recognized because the trials you're going through. It promotes an environment for spiritual growth. I always get closer to God when things aren't going so great. When things are going great, I just do this now and lay me down to sleep prayers. When things are going rough, me and God get down to business. It helps me refocus my attention toward God. We get so caught up in the blessing that we forget the blesser. We're just so fired up. Who's got the biggest whatever? Who got the most? They got the most faith because look at what they. No. God's promotions and the world promotions are two different things. And it conforms me to the image of Christ. When I go through things and I have to lean on the Father, then it conforms me to an image where Jesus himself in the garden said, Father, I don't want to go through this. It's going to hurt. I do not want to go through this. Let this cup pass over me. If there's any other way to do this, let it be done. Jesus said that. If there's any other way, let it be done. But nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. When you can get to that point, you realize the point of that trial. God often uses our deepest pain as a launching pad to our greatest call. Bethany lived going on 30 years. She's dead. Earthly lives. But I've passed out well over 1,000. God's got this. The people I don't even know, they start asking me about this. And they say, tell me about Bethany. And I start telling them about Bethany. Oh man, I'm not giving this to them. Take it right off my hand, put it on theirs. In the last week, I've given like 5 pounds on my arm. And every time I give it to the person they were going through something, I give it to them. And when I put it on their arm, they started crying. And this is why. But it's such a powerful testimony. I'm a 27-year-old. We get things so mixed up. We don't realize God's working something in us that can't be worked any other way. Oh, this was the very first of his problems with relations.
his wife. He's got some well-meaning friends that come along. And they reclaim a blab and grab it deal. And talk about how bad he was. And if he hadn't been so bad, he wouldn't have been going through this. Which played on Job saying, what I feared the most has come upon me. His friends played on that fear. Because they didn't realize Satan was using them. God's got this. God's got this. God's got this. Because the book of Job, although we're not through, one thing I want you to know is, just like there was a beginning, there was an end. And the end was awesome. Absolutely awesome. Everybody stand. DC complacent. Job tells me that not all my trials are from what I did. That sometimes God is bragging on me. If God opens the door, there's a reason. There's a purpose. It also tells me that Satan's looking for ways, finding cleats and chinks in my armor to invade. But it also tells me that God's still in control even in that. Because he told him what he was allowed to do in each trial. And he couldn't go any further. There was limits. And in the end, Job was a blessed, blessed, blessed man. You may be here today, and you feel like life has thrown you a curveball. Everybody, bow your head, close your eyes. You may be here today and think life's throwing you a curveball. You're going through something and Satan's telling you, because he's the accuser of the brethren. He's telling you the reason you're going through these trials is because you blew it somewhere. You didn't cross all your T's. You didn't dot all your spiritual I's. And so you're going through this problem all because you've been bad, 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 bad. Job was not bad, 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 bad. Job was good. Matter of fact, God said he was the best. Now,
get myself back right with God, because I thought he had left me. I thought he was through with me. I thought it was over, and so I backed away. But now, I'm ready to clean again, because I know. You want to get strong with God again. You want to get back in there with him. You realize he's not trying to kill you. He's not trying to hurt you. He's even guiding your trial. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here and you're saying, you know, now I know I need to get back in there with God because God's got this one. Nobody look at you. Would you put that hand up quickly? Say, I need to get back there. I need it. Maybe you're here today and you're just going through something. I'm not God. I can't tell you why you're going through it. I have no idea. There is times we bring it on ourselves. There's times where we get trapped by Satan. There's times where God opens the door. So whether you were trapped by Satan, whether you brought it on yourself, or whether God opened the door, I don't know, but I can tell you this. Even in all of that, God's still in control. Amen? So if you're here right now, and you're going through something, it's hard to understand, but you just want the strength to keep holding on to believing God in all this, just to believe him. Just strength to go through this. Nobody else looking around. Let's put a hand up. I need strength. Let's all pray together. Father, I know there's no way I will ever figure this out. But I trust you, God, because you already had it figured out before it started. And I thank you that you still have things under control. Help me to draw close to you, to hold your hand, and believe that you got this. Help me not to let go, because I know you won't. And I thank you for it. I thank you for strength. I thank you for comfort. I thank you for hope. In the name of Jesus, I also thank you for allowing me to be conformed into the image of your Son. In the name of Jesus, I thank you. Give Lord a hand clap.
Having a ball.